Dear members and viewers of the White Army, welcome you all for at another special session about career counseling. Today we have a session on how to select a super specialty branch in medicine. It's a much awaited discussion actually. Many residents, in fact the PG aspirants are also requesting for a session because nowadays the proper guidance is not seen from the seniors. So in this regard, juniors are suffering in selecting a proper PG post-graduation or super specialty branch and repenting later on. In order to avoid all these things, now today we have got best possible mentors to guide in this regard. So let's have an interactive session to guide for the selection of super specialty branch in medicine. As mentors, we have today from the branch of gastroenterology, we have Dr. Vijay sir. He did his MD medicine from Bangalore Medical College and then went on to do DM in most prestigious SGPGA Lucknow. And he's also a mentor of White Army as well, conducted many sessions. Welcome to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Kishan, for nice introduction.
Yeah. And from the branch of oncology, we have yet another eminent personality, Dr. Santosh sir. He did his MD from the St. John's Medical College, Bangalore, and DM Oncology from the most premier institute of our country, that is Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai. He's presently working as an assistant professor in MS Ramaya Medical College and HCG BMT Wing. Welcome to you, sir. We are really privileged to have you today. Welcome to Santosh, sir. From neurology, we have Dr. Sharad sir, who is currently doing a residency in neurology in one of the best institutes of our country. There is Sri Chitra Thirunal Institute for Medical Sciences and Technology, Thiruvananthapuram. He is very good, known for his clinical acumen, and also is very known to very well known to guide his juniors. He's also taken many sessions in White Army as well. Welcome to you, sir, Sharad sir.
Thank you, Kishan.
From Department of Cardiology, we have our own Dr. Sudhamshu sir. He did his MD and DM cardiology from PGA Chandigarh, and now he is a consultant at Apollo Chandigarh. And we will listen to him soon. Yeah, instead of telling more about him, you will realize soon when we all listen to him. Welcome to you, Sudhamshu sir. Welcome to you.
Thank you.
Representing the department of and branch of nephrology, we have Dr. Pramod sir. Dr. Pramod GR, he did DM nephrology from St. John's Medical College, Bangalore, and currently working as assistant professor in SS Medical College, Davanagere. Welcome to you, Pramod sir.
Thank you.
We are really honored to have you today in the White Army's special session. And also, dear members, this session is meant for our the postgraduates in medicine field as well as the PG aspirants who are aiming for specialties later on. These are the five major branches we have selected today, five or six. Also, we have so many other branches in the field of medicine like endocrinology, rheumatology, and so on. We will also be dealing about branches. We have some five common questions for all our mentors today. Like, first of all, dear members, you need to guide us about what are the merits and demerits of your particular branch. Okay, frankly, we need your opinion from your experience as well as the working environment and everything. We want frank opinion regarding the merits and demerits of your particular subject. Secondly, if I am a particular specialist, what's the scope in our country as well as even abroad, maybe? If I do the DM or the DMB, what's the scope in the future? Also, I want to know about any further options available. For example, after a medical gastroenterology, can I do fellowship in hepatology or something like that? Any fellowship options or anything further options to study available in your particular branch, I wanted to know. And what are the few major important considerations we should do before opting your particular subject? Anything to be like, any maybe as simple as physical fitness maybe, or endurance, any virtues or any qualities required for excellent to consider your branch? And finally, this question is already answered when we chose you as a mentor, sir. Fifth question is, any recommend institution? We have all our six mentors from the best possible institution in the particular branch. For example, SGPG is the best for the gastro, and Tata, no need to say, it's the best for onco, and cardiology is PGO. So from the mentors, college itself is the best. Even then, if you have any other better suggestions, you please can guide us on that regard also. The three or four best recommended institution for your branch. So we shall start the and today's as moderator we have Dr. Vijay Balaji, who is also a DM aspirant, currently doing a third year MD residency in MS Ramaiah Medical College, Bangalore, and also a core member of White Army. Welcome to you, Vijay Balaji. And over to the moderator. And once again, we welcome all the mentors, and over to you, Balaji.
Yes, sir. Welcome to all the mentors. So the standard list of the five important questions, we'll proceed in this order. Sir, first, let us Sudhamshu sir to speak about the branch of cardiology. So your views on the branch, sir.
Thank you, Krishan, for a nice welcome. Hi, my name is Dr. Sudhanshu. I have done my MBBS from Mysore Medical College and my MD in internal medicine and DM in cardiology from PGH Chandigarh. So, Krishan has already asked the questions. These questions, I'll be quite practical about all of the questions. So, and I'll be telling you from my own personal experience. So as far as the merits of cardiology is concerned, I hope these questions are for those candidates who are confused when they are planning to go for a DM branch. So if you are somebody who has actually made their mind and who have always dreamt about being a particular super specialist like cardiologist or gastroenterologist, then these questions are not for you, because obviously your choice and your dreams, you know, they are the foremost. But if you are confused about which branch to take, the merits in cardiology is one, which is the most important, is there are a lot of seats, first of all. Right? So you, even 6 months of preparation can prepare you for a seat in cardiology. There are a lot of seats, and although the candidates are also too many, but considering the huge number of seats, because cardiology has been developing as a super specialty branch for quite a long time now. And that is why most of the institutes and most of the places in India will have, most of the medical colleges will have a cardiology branch. So if you are somebody who, you know, wants to stay close to their home and has, you know, a regional predilection, like if you want to stay close to your own place, you have some family commitments, then definitely cardiology is one branch which you can pursue, because you will definitely find a seat close to your place. And it will be very easy to get into cardiology, not very easy, but definitely easier than some branches like rheumatology or endocrinology, because considering the huge number of seats which are available. Second merit, which I would say is, obviously it is one of the most revered branch of medicine in super specialty, very well developed, a lot of interventions. So if you are somebody who likes to do interventions, who has been always fascinated by putting center lines, putting ICTDs, doing LPs, doing pleural tap. So cardiology will give you, you know, it is mainly focused on interventions. And since the branch has been developing a lot of research has been going on, most of the focus of this branch is on interventions. So if you are somebody who likes to be in that, you know, high voltage area, who wants to do a lot of interventions, who wants to practice interventions a lot, cardiology is the branch for you. Another merit is, practically speaking, cardiologists are well paid in the country. So salary-wise, you will find, you know, you won't find yourself in a fix after you have finished cardiology. Another merit is, wherever you join, you will find good teachers, because most of the cardiologists in the country have been you know, training for a lot of years, and most of the professors in college, they are quite experienced. They have been in this field for 30-40 years. So once you join that college, most of the colleges, you'll find good professors, well-experienced good professors who can teach you interventions, who can guide you further. So you will not have any difficulty after you join the branch in finding the path for you, in finding what you are, want to do, where you want to pursue, where you want to practice. You will find that these professors have been training in this field for 30-40 years. They have a lot of experience in interventions, in research, a lot of paper publications. So you can always pursue this branch, and you can go to different medical colleges, pursue in academics also, or in private also if you want to work in interventions. Another merit, I would say that since a lot of research goes in this branch, you will find a lot of new things coming up in cardiology. You will find a lot of new interventions are coming up, a lot of new technologies are coming up. So it is never boring in cardiology. I mean, you will never be bored of the branch. You will find a lot of new procedures, new interventions are coming up. You have a lot to learn, and every new research that comes up, you will find doing something new. And most of the times, you will see that cardiologists, they end up refuting their own hypothesis, their own guidelines, and they come up with something new, and then the entire thing will change. And it will be one fun-filled adventure for you even after you have finished your cardiology. So to sum it up, it will never be boring in cardiology for you. And also, as far as treating patients is concerned, one thing that you will really like in cardiology is that patients will be quite happy with you and your practice, because it's very simple. Cardiology is not like internal medicine. It's not like house MD. You have to do a lot of thinking. You don't have to do a lot of diagnosis. Most of it is already researched upon. You have a few drugs, and patient respond to the medicine quite well. And almost 90-95% of your patients will be, quite happy with whatever you treat, wherever you treat. You can treat and sitting in a third tier city, and they'll be quite happy with your treatment. They'll go for years altogether without any problems, without any troubles, and they'll be very happy with whatever way you treat them. So that is one more thing that you'll be happy with wherever you practice. Coming to demerits of this branch, the merits itself are also demerits of this branch. It is a high voltage branch. So again, you will have to get up during nighttime. Most of your days, you will have a lot of MIs there. MIs have a predilection to come, especially during nighttime. You cannot stay, you cannot go into cardiology thinking that it is a, 10 to 4 or 10 to 5 job. You will have to practice most of your cardiology in nighttime. You will have to be awake most of the nights. And since, as I said, a lot of doctors are already practicing cardiology, again, settling in first tier cities will be quite a job in this branch. You'll have to face a lot of competition from well-settled cardiologists who are already practicing in most of the big cities. So if you are somebody who belongs to a big city like Bangalore or Mysore, for that matter, or Delhi, so you will have to face a lot of competition. The learning curve is more in this. So you'll have to go through a lot of learning, even after you've finished your course. You'll have to practice under some senior consultant for quite a few years, and then you'll have to improve your skills slowly. And that is how, it will take some time. And then again, another demerit is that the setup, if you are somebody who wants to open their own setup, who wants to have their own hospital or their own setup in their hometown or something like that, the setup in this is a little costly. So again, just like any other surgeon or orthopedician, you will have to, spend for that. So whenever if you're planning to choose this branch, do keep this in mind, where you belong to, which place you belong to, what is the scene in cardiology there, what is the scope there, how many doctors are already practicing there, whether there is scope for cardiology there, or if you are ready to be to shift somewhere else to practice this branch. And most of the merits and demerits are these only. But if you are like undecided, then you can think on these merits and demerits and decide which branch to choose. Shall I go ahead with the other points, or you want to say something, Dr. Vijay?
Yes, sir. What's the scope? of cardiology?
So as I said, already there are a lot of doctors practicing in India. There are a lot of cardiologists. So if you want to, I hope by scope, you mean the amount of practice you are going to do outside, right? Once you come out of it, yeah. So in first tier cities, in metro cities, you'll have to face a lot of competition. You'll have to work under mentors and doctor senior consultants for a few years. And then you can definitely, join a hospital as an independent consultant. But if you go to second or third tier cities, nowadays cardiology has gone to third tier cities. So small towns have started coming up with their own cath labs and all. So if you want to practice, you will have to, for initial few years of your practice, you might have to travel, like from Bangalore to, you'll have to travel to Hosur or something like that nearby, or Mysore to Kollegal or something, some like 1 hour distance from your place. So you might have to do up and down or stay at a second tier or third tier town and practice there for some time and build your patient base. And once patients know you, then you can shift to a first tier city. So settling is a little bit of an issue. When coming to even medical colleges also, already the branch is quite established in most of the medical colleges. So getting a consultancy post in medical colleges, again, it will be a tough job. Because most of the consultants are already there, and very few seats you are going to get in this available branch. So, and a lot of cardiologists will come out, obviously, from wherever you see a lot of people will opt for cardiology, and a lot of people will come out. So that is there. So that also is going to be a little tough task once you come out of cardiology. As far as going outside India is concerned, it will not be the favored branch. If you're going outside India, you can apply for fellowships. There are a lot of fellowships in cardiology. I mean, you can do a fellowship in electrophysiology, interventional cardiology, you can do in structural heart interventions, and all these fellowships are done outside. In India also, you have fellowships in electrophysiology in Jipmer and Vellore, so in Jayadeva also. So you can opt for these fellowships if you want to practice outside. If you want to settle outside, probably suppose if you plan to go outside after you have finished cardiology, then it is going to be a little difficult, because most of the countries will have a little difficulty in accepting a cardiologist from outside, because again, it is intervention branch. Both cardiology and gastroenterology will have this problem if you plan to go out. So intervention branch, if you want to go to Australia, UK or US, you will have a little difficulty, even Canada. So fellowships, you can go outside, but if you want to go to US, you'll have to start again from MD internal medicine and do your residency and then come to cardiology, and it will be a long procedure after that. So in that way, it won't be a favored branch if you want to practice outside after your cardiology. So as far as scope is concerned, you will find a job that is there. It's not that you won't find a good job, but you might have to move outside metros in initial periods. Yeah, Vijay.
What are the further options after finishing DM or DMD cardiology?
Okay. So as I said, you have fellowships in interventional cardiology, you have fellowships in Singapore, you have fellowships in Korea, you have fellowships in Canada, US, UK, Australia gives fellowships in pediatric cardiology. You have fellowships in structural heart interventions like TAVR and all. They are coming up. Quite fascinating things. You have fellowships in electrophysiology. So you can actually go do these fellowships outside or even in India and then come back and practice as that particular doctor. You can practice as an electrophysiologist in India. You can practice only structural heart interventions. You can practice only pediatric cardiology in India. That also you can do. You can be a pediatric cardiologist, you can be electrophysiologist, and they're quite well established also. So you can do these fellowships and continue narrowing your focus to a particular field, and definitely there are a lot of things. A lot of people nowadays are going for fellowships, especially people around me. I've seen a lot of people, they go for fellowships outside, they go to USA and do electrophysiology fellowships. Are very famous in our field. So that is there. And then other than this, if you don't want to do anything, any further studies, then definitely you can practice as a consultant in private or in any medical college. AIIMS, most of the AIIMS are coming up in Rishikesh, Jodhpur. All these AIIMS have started cardiology department. And cardiology is the first department to start in most of the institutes once super specialty gets established. So you will definitely find a post for a AP there. So you can practice as a consultant. You can be academically oriented if you go to medical colleges, or if you want to just do interventions, want to practice in private. Most of the private setups nowadays have cardiology, and you can practice around. So that you'll have no issue.
Sudhanshu sir, what are the basic qualities or like what are the prerequisites to take up for as personally? What are the prerequisites for taking up the cardiology, sir?
So as such, there is no prerequisite. If you ask me, the first thing that which I faced is
I have one. If you want to eat up all the bread and butter of cardiac surgeons, then you will take.
Definitely. Nowadays, everything is becoming cardiology oriented. But one thing I would say is what I realized after I joined my cardiology is I am a left-handed guy. So I did not know till the day I entered my cath lab, you know, like 1 year into cardiology, I did not know that entire cardiology setup, everything is meant for right-handed people. So when I entered and I realized, okay, everything is for right-handed people. So it took me around 1 or 2 months, you know, to get adjusted to the entire setup. So that is one thing which... I have to be ambidextrous now. Now I am ambidextrous. I can practice with both my hands, and there is no issue after that. So it's not meant to discourage any left-handed person. If anybody is listening to this left-handed guy, so I have been doing practicing cardiology for last 5 years, and I've been doing all the interventions, and it does not affect your caliber, I must say. But yeah, initially when you come, you are taken aback, you are taken by a surprise that okay, everything is meant for right-handed people, and then you have to, you know, practice for 1 or 2 months all the minute movements and everything. You'll have to practice for 2-3 months. So that is one thing that you have to keep in mind. Other than that, if you are into interventions, if you get scared easily, I would say that, you know, try to have a big heart before you enter cardiology, because you will have these things happening around you. Like in few seconds, the patient will go from all hello, hello, tata, bye bye to all down. So if you get scared easily and you are scared by the sight of blood, I would say that I don't think anybody who's doing medicine would be scared by the sight of blood. Most of us see blood day in and out. So if you are into interventions and everything, if you like doing putting central lines and all, then definitely cardiology is the branch for you. And if you like to be in that, you know, high voltage setup and everything, then I would say that you can do it. Okay, there is a message from someone.
Sir, can you please recommend some institutes for the department, or like for the branch of cardiology?
Okay, so first of all, the central institutes are all good. So if you say, I would say my mother institute, PGH Chandigarh, quite good for cardiology. A lot of interventions, a lot of hands-on. So it's a very, quite a good institute. Other than that, AIIMS Delhi, GB Pant Delhi, SGPGI Lucknow, all other AIIMS that are coming up. Rishikesh Jodhpur are also good. Sri Chitra in South. And then most of the medical colleges, state medical colleges are quite good. Quite good. St. John's is good. Jayadeva is very good for cardiology. If you want to go to Bangalore, Jayadeva is the institute you should look for. And again, Ramaya is also good. Other than this, most of the medical, the advantage of cardiology is that, you know, it has been there in most of the state medical colleges for quite long time. And most of the state medical colleges have huge number of patients. So you will get good hands-on and good patients in most of the medical colleges. And you can go for most of the good prime medical colleges of any state. And I would recommend that, like Indira Gandhi Medical College in Shimla and KGMC in Lucknow, Bangalore Medical College, Madras Medical College, and even in Kerala, other than the Sri Chitra, you have Trivandrum Medical College. Most of the colleges are good for this learning interventions in cardiology.
Sir, Sudhanshu sir, is physical disability and contraindication for taking?
Okay. Yeah, I saw that message. I don't think so. I mean, if you have been doing medicine, if you have been practicing medicine, you have been moving in and out of ward, you have been working in medicine, you can do practice cardiology. There is, I mean, unless and until you have I don't think so. I have friends who have had a little bit of physical disability, but I don't think it affects. I mean, cardiology is something, if once you have, you know, finished your course, you have your own lab, you're where you're practicing, you're doing your course, you can actually sit on a stool and do interventions. Nobody says that you have to stand and do it. We have our cardiologists who are above 40 years, 45, 50 years, who sit on a stool and do cases aramse. So I don't think, unless and until it has something to do with your hand and maybe you are not able to do some minute movements with your fingers, I don't think it is going to be a problem. I have friends who have physical disabilities and who are differentially able, but even then they have been practicing cardiology quite well. I don't think it affects your...
What's the earning potential of your budding, like what a junior cardiologist, sir?
Okay, cardiologist, cardiologists, quite frankly, and being practical, they are paid well. They are paid well. It is one of the most well-paid branches in India, and at par with, you know, good practicing surgeons and orthopedicians, at par with them, and definitely one of the best super specialty branches as far as salary is concerned in medicine. So if you are a medicine guy and if you want to practice, take up super specialty just for salary increment and just for money sake, definitely cardiology is your branch.
Sir, and do we not need to know this echo, doing echo beforehand, before joining? Because I have seen first year residents doing echo and all here. So do we need to know all this before joining the cardiology, like DM, no, or is it a part of DM resident?
No. You don't have to know anything about cardiology before you enter cardiology. You just have to read the books, clear the exams, and once you enter, they'll teach you everything. You have echoes. You will do so many echoes that you will become well versed with doing echoes. You will do 200, 300 echoes when you're posted in echo every day, 300 echoes per day, and you'll be, and once you come out, you'll be doing, you would have done almost 20,000-30,000 echoes. So I don't think it matters. I don't think it matters.
Thank you for your kind words and of guidance, sir. We know that you have an emergency case, so at least please try to spend some more time with us. If any of our members come up with any questions, sir, please you can answer them.
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Krishan.
Thank you, sir. We'll move on to Dr. Santosh, sir, another eminent personality with us today, oncologist. Santosh, sir. Are you there?
Yeah, hi, Kishan. Thanks, Balaji, for inviting me. So I will go through the points that you require me to comment upon right away. So the merits and demerits of the field. I'm a medical oncologist. So there are three main branches in oncology, that is surgical oncology and radiation oncology. So post MD medicine, you have to want to go to oncology or to do medical oncology. So medical oncologists, as a broad overview, treat cancers, both solid tumors and hematological malignancies. So it depends on what your interests are. Then you can branch out further into a specific solid tumor or specific hematological malignancies, as they are doing in the Western countries and Europe. So coming to the merits, it's a upcoming branch. There were very few oncologists, medical oncologists in the country for many, many years. Early as say 5 years ago, there were hardly 100 seats in the country. Now, latest figures last year were about 130 DM seats, and about a similar number of DNB seats are available in the country. So the number of training seats are increasing. So that's about the seats, and it's one of the fields where obviously, unlike as Dr. Sudhanshu said, like cardiology, it's an old branch. Here it's a new branch, especially for our country, and lots of research being done, and practically we tend to change practice every week in each tumor. So you need to continuously read. That may be a merit or a demerit. So there are new treatment options like immunotherapy and cellular therapy that are curing more and more patients. So a couple of years ago, Dr. James Allison, who got the Nobel Prize, was awarded for coming up with a new treatment option for cancers that is called immunotherapy. So we deal with chemotherapy, immunotherapy, cellular therapy. We medical oncologists like me do bone marrow transplants too. So it's a vast and very interesting field. Gives you good satisfaction with your work. And if you see the burnout figures, especially in the West, where data is collected very systematically, that is doctor burnout figures, it is one of the least in medical oncology. Contrary to what you expect, you may feel ki patients are dying, patients are not doing very well. It's not true. A lot of patients do very well. A lot of patients are cured when you treat them with various treatment options available in treating cancers. So then one more thing is your patients who require treatment by a medical oncologist constantly increases. That's mainly because of the aging population and more people adopting Western lifestyles. So though the number of patients keep increasing, for example, India has the least number of cancer patients per capita or per 1,000 or a million population compared to the West. And we have more and more, as we adopt Western lifestyles, the number of cancer patients are only going to increase, and the number of medical oncologists needing to treat these patients are only going to increase. That is one of the reasons why the NMC or the previous MCHI has less strict criteria for being a teacher in a for medical oncology program compared to other branches. So as a professor, you can have 4 students. As an associate professor, you can have 3 students. And even as assistant professor, you can have 2 students under you according to NMC rules, which are much more liberal because the government wants more medical oncologists to come out into the market. And the number of training institutes are definitely less compared to other branches. So that is about the seats. And because the field is exploding so fast, the field is moving more and more into organ-based practice. So people are, for example, in our institute, I have moved more mainly into hematolymphoid malignancies and breast and gynec malignancies only. I have let go of other malignancies to just be able to keep up with the literature that is increasing in amount on a weekly basis. So coming to the job, getting a job or a position is not very, very difficult at present. It's slowly getting saturated in the big cities, but eventually in the couple of next 2-3 years, it will eventually get saturated in big cities and people will have to move to smaller cities or join in as associate consultants and then move up the ladder. And one more thing that is interesting is medico-legally compared to other branches, for example, cardiology, where patients come in with heart attack and sometimes if the patients die, there is a bigger backlash from the family because they expect the patient to do well. In medico-legally, you have more time to deal with patients and especially if it is a metastatic disease, they know that patient is not going to do well and you may be slightly less risky compared to other more active branches like cardiology and gastroenterology. But it is not a guarantee. You can still get into trouble medico-legally, but overall, probably I feel that it is slightly less risky compared to other branches which have interventions. So coming to the demerits of the field, there is definite stigma attached to cancer, and treating cancer also there is a definite stigma attached to it. Lot of MD medicine postgraduates do not rotate through medical oncology units in their hospitals because they don't have the units, oncology units in their hospitals. And most of them do not know the nuances of the field for them to choose the branch. And that is why a lot of people, MD medicine postgraduates, are not opting for the branch. Though I feel it is a wonderful branch to take up. When I was rotating in oncology in St. John's Hospital, that's how I developed interest in the field, and I took up this field. However, medicine students may not be very fortunate to rotate in medical oncology. So definitely as a demerit, one needs an attachment to a large hospital which has all specialties, because including a radiation machine and including a surgical oncology team there, being there with you, because it is quite a bit of a teamwork. And in fact, a lot of hospitals, when they are doing their electronic medical systems, do come to oncology because if they crack medical oncology in their electronic medical records, they crack all other branches, because you need to work with radiologists, pathologists, with interventional radiologists, with the radiation oncologist, and also with surgical oncologists. So it's a team game, and you need to have good people skills. If you work and like working in a team, it's a wonderful field to be in. And especially as was discussed previously, it's investment heavy, and if you want to set up a full oncology setup, it will cost not less than 30 crore rupees. So definitely you need to work in a hospital unless you are very, very rich. Then unfortunately in our country, as a demerit, it's the training is yet not streamlined. So there is a bit of overlap in the training between other fields. For example, the branch of DM hematology. So for example, if you get into a DM hematology, you train in benign hematology and you train in malignant hematology. That is, you treat blood cancers and you treat benign blood diseases. When you treat in medical, train in medical oncology, you train in cancer. So you train in treating solid tumors, the chemotherapy and immunotherapy part, and also you train blood cancers. So there is severe competition between hematology and medical oncology to treat the overlapping subject, that is blood cancers and bone marrow transplant. So however, a lot of medical oncologists are giving up blood cancers, but some continue to do it. Like for example, me, I continue to do blood cancers as main practice and also bone marrow transplant. So one of the demerits, definitely, as I was alluding to previously, is need constant reading and update. So we need to eventually go to smaller and smaller sets of oncology to be the best in the field and to do justice to your patients. Though many patients are not cured of their disease, especially in solid tumors, that is one of the demerits. At least about 40 to 50% of the patients may not eventually be cured if they have metastatic disease, and many of your patients will die. So there is an emotional component to it, which you need to be aware of. And if you are reasonably emotionally strong, then I think this is a field to be in. Coming to the scope of work, so if you like pharmacology, pathology, and medicine, this is the field to be in. There is a lot of pharmacology, a lot of drugs, lot of pathology involved, lot of molecular pathology involved that you need to know and understand, and lots of medicine. This is, I think, one of the closest branches to medicine in whole of super specialty fields. Maybe nephrology comes close to it in terms of how close to medicine it is as a field. So then scope in terms of work post DM, you can work in a medical college, you can work in a corporate hospital, which can be a general corporate hospital, which caters to all the diseases, or cancer specialty corporate hospital, or you could also set up your own center. You can choose to work in a specific organ, as I was talking to you previously. This definitely may strange to medicine postgraduates, because you feel ki once you do your DM, you are the expert in the field. There is bad news for you. It is not true. Once you get into your super specialty, once you get your DM, then you realize that how less you know in a particular tumor type or any particular branch in other fields too, and how you need to further subspecialize in a particular subset of tumors to get better at it and to definitely do justice to your patients. So, and also other scope of work includes an opportunity to be in clinical trials. So the clinical trials can be phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, phase 4. So phase 3 trials are the most exciting type of clinical trials, where you get drugs into the market, where you test drugs and their efficacy. And this is something we do routinely, and that is quite exciting. So you can also be part of industry. If you don't like clinical practice, you can be appointed in one of the drug companies at very high positions if you are a DM in medical oncology, and you can say head the medical team of say Bristol Myers, which is a multinational drug company. I'm just giving an example. So or say Pfizer, which is also into vaccines and also into oncology. So many people also can take a research predominant career, because one part of medicine that needs to be fully cracked yet is oncology. There's huge amount of research going on in this area, and you can do a predominant research. You can spend quite a bit of time in research and do a little bit of clinics also. That also can be quite rewarding. So going to the next heading of further positions, as I spoke previously, you can be a predominant clinician, you can be a predominant scientist, you can be a clinician scientist. So I right now I'm focusing on stem cell transplantation and cellular therapy, and also do breast and gynecological cancer. So things to consider as a personality trait before you opt for this. It is not a field where there is a lot of procedure, like a cath lab procedure or a endoscopy procedure that you get to see in other branches, or a dialysis that needs to be done in a sick patient. This is not a procedural branch. There's a lot of drugs and pathology involved, and a lot of reading involved. So it's a branch that needs solid medicine knowledge, and you need to be a good medical oncologist. You also need to be a good physician. I keep telling this, you need to constantly read and update. And if you are somebody who doesn't like reading, this is not the field to be in. I tend to read practically every day, 2 to 3 hours. On a Sunday today, I've been reading from morning till now before I spoke to you. So other personality trait is empathy. You need to empathize with your patients. They can have niggling problems. You can't lose patience with them. That is a very important personality trait that is true to all doctors, but more so for us in this field of medical oncology. You definitely, unlike other fields where it's a single procedure and patient goes away and comes for a follow-up sometime later, you need to see patients, the same patients again and again for chemotherapy cycles or post-procedure visits. So you make a strong bond with the patients and their families, and you probably know what their families do, what they do. And eventually, this is one area which is very different from other fields where you tend to develop a strong bond with the patients and their families. So the last heading is the recommended institutions. Right now in the NMC website, has about 139 seats for DM medical oncology and a similar number of seats for DNB. The best center, I think, is either Tata Memorial Hospital or AIIMS New Delhi. Other good centers include Adyar in Chennai, NIMS Hyderabad, RCC Trivandrum, and there are good DNB centers too that you could opt for. And there are many private centers with good training programs, with good exposures, that you need to do a little bit of homework with the students already working there before you make your decisions about choosing the hospital in which you want to train in. I think that's it.
Santosh sir, one best, yeah, very, very, very nicely, very good insight, sir. But one thing, what you know about, like what we're learning about the oncology is, it's no more a palliative branch, sir. It's more of a curative branch nowadays. It's no more remains a palliative branch like earlier. Now, like you told, a lot of development research into it. Even in the stage 3 and some even maybe stage 4 also, you are trying to cure the disease. So it has got a huge scope and a lot of benefits in the branch. So can you highlight briefly about that?
Yes. Like for example, I'll just take an example of breast cancer. About in stage 3 breast cancer, you are able to cure about 70 to 80% of patients with the present set of drugs and targeted therapy. That is with combination of surgery, radiation, and medical oncology intervention. I'll just give you an example of interesting example of how immunotherapy has transformed lives of patients and really change practice. A patient with malignant melanoma, with disease from head to toe, with stage 4 malignant melanoma, sometime back would die in 2 to 3 months. Right now, I have few patients of malignant melanoma on immunotherapy drugs for the last 2.5 years. On the PET scan, there is no disease. They're in complete remission. So this is just an example of how things have changed. And how it can be very, very rewarding. Though, mind you, that at present, these drugs are very expensive. And the difficult part of our practice is lot of patients can't afford these drugs. And that is something that we need to deal day in and day out about the cost of treatment. That is definitely, I didn't mention it before, that is definitely a demerit of the branch. And however, eventually the cost of the drugs will come down.
So one question.
Sir, that was really interesting and inspiring, sir. Santosh, sir, really very valuable set of like guidance, I would say. Sir, now we'll request, sir, we'll wait for the residents' questions and then please be with us, sir, for some more time, Santosh, sir.
Thank you.
And now we'll move on to our another senior mentor with us, Dr. Vijay sir. Are you there, Vijay sir? So we are eagerly waiting to listen to you.
Kishan, hello.
Yes, sir, we can hear you.
Can you hear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, hi. So welcome to this session. So we had a lot of important and very useful session. I had two sessions with Vijay Balaji from his YTA meeting. So today this is quite a different session rather than it's one-to-one teaching. So gastroenterology is one such subject where I can say most of your life will be full of interventions. Because the moment patient comes to a gastroenterologist, obviously they'll be filtered by this the primary ABBS doctors, then by the MD medicine, and then patient comes to a gastroenterologist. So in reality, about 80 to 90% of patients who come to your OPD will need some sort of intervention. Most often, it will not be a mere just upper GI endoscopy or just colonoscopy, something like that. It will be beyond that. So that's the main, I can say, merit of our subject. And people who are interested in doing any interventions, you know, who want to be partial surgeons or something like that, definitely gastroenterology is one of the branch which they should choose. Another important thing is advancements. You know, day by day we are advancing. Of course, Sudhanshu will agree that cardiology and gastroenterology are two subjects. You know, we are taking a lot of procedures from surgeons. So achalasia, 10 years ago, it was managed by surgeons. Today, it's managed by gastroenterologists. So all diverticulum, etc., all those things which we used to read when we were doing MBBS and post-graduation that surgeons used to manage, slightly there's a shift from the surgical to endoscope-based interventions. And even we have creeped into this endoscopic management of obesity. So another main merit of my subject is that there is no saturation, you know, wherever you go in India, whether it's Bangalore, Delhi, no saturation in subjects, and there's a lot of scope. So, coming to demerits, I wouldn't say demerits, of course, each and every branch or a subspecialty in medicine has their own merits and demerits, but there are a lot of, you know, setbacks which you should know before choosing this branch. The one is dependency. You know, to be in a good setup, you should have a good friends around you. So you should have a good backup of surgical gastro, should have a good pathologist, you know, pathologist who can specifically who is well-versed in this identifying gastrointestinal specimen. You should have a good pathologist, you should have a good oncologist and radiologist. So only with these your colleagues or, you know, it's a dependable subject. It's not that you are a good gastroenterologist and you can do a good job. No. Unless you have a good, these fellows, radiologists, surgeons and everything. So that's a little demerit. You know, you go to a good setup with all good endoscopic equipment, but if a pathologist is not reporting specimens or if your radiologist is not discussing the findings and everything, it may be slightly difficult for you to manage those things. Second is a learning curve. As I told you that almost 3/4 of our daily time or OPD time is in procedures. Learning curve, it's I can say 3 to 5 years after your DM, you have to dedicate yourselves towards learning. It's not that you complete DM gastroenterology, come out of it and you start doing procedures from day one. It takes time. Of course, basic procedures will be a part of your DM training program. All of us can do it. But beyond that, to reach a certain extent, you need to invest time. You need another 3 to 5 years, at least 3 to 5 years. You need to work under some trained gastroenterologist, good mentor, where you have all the settings. So another demerit I would like to say is, see, ours is a branch of where we deal with intervention. So you have to be ready to accept failures. You know, yesterday we had a lot of intra-op ERCPs in our hospital. Of course, I tried, my senior tried, our HOD tried. We were unable to complete the procedure. Actually, we failed. So you should have that courage to face failures in your life. So that's a part of our intervention. So if you're ready for that, please go ahead with gastroenterology. And the setting, once you complete DM and come out, it's usually difficult for a well-trained gastroenterologist to settle in the tier 3 cities or talukas or districts. It's very difficult. So you need a good backup, and unless you have financially stable, let us say, to establish a good endoscopic setup, you need at least 25 to 40 lakhs. If you want to set up, have your own setting. If you want to work under a good hospital in a good corporate setup, definitely gastroenterology has cut it over other subjects. So, Kishan, am I audible?
Clearly, sir, clearly. Very interesting, sir, please.
So, the next question is about the scope of subjects. Of course, each and every subspecialty has its own merits, demerits, everything. But gastroenterology, it's not yet saturated. I can say even now we don't have any good government medical colleges in Karnataka where you have a gastro department. Except I think Bangalore Medical College, no other government medical colleges have this department. And there are a lot of upcoming aims throughout India. There are remember there are 13 institutes where there is still opening. Even today you have opening for gastroenterologists. So there's no saturation. You can go ahead and, you know, the opportunities are more. And coming to institutes, so you can work in institute, but the only disadvantage of that is that the opportunities may be less. You know, you might have just one or two vacancies in the institutes. And there are a lot of medical colleges, plenty of medical colleges, I can say, where there is openings for gastroenterologists. So further options available after DM or DNB. After DM or DNB, you have a one-year course, you have 6 months course, you have 4 to 6 week course, and you have short-term training. So you have postdoctoral fellowship in motility disorders, postdoctoral fellowship in pancreatology, postdoctoral fellowship in advanced endoscopy. This advanced endoscopy includes US and US guided procedures. So there are a few institutes I'll be telling in my talk where you have this advanced fellowship programs. There is something called a short-term training, like 6 months fellowship, or you have even 18 weeks or somewhere around 4 month fellowships. You can do fellowships in liver transplant. Even though there is something called hepatology. Hepatology is a sister subject which mainly deals with liver-related disorders, particularly in a transplant setting. So even after doing DM gastroenterology or interested in liver and related things, you can go ahead with 1 year training in transplant hepatology or hepatology. Short-term courses like endosuturing. You know, last year I got trained in Spain for this endosuturing where we tackle obesity. There's a lot of endoscopic management of obesity, endoscopic management of reflux disease. So endosuturing is something which you can learn in 2 to 4 week short-term training. There's something called US guided interventions, which you can learn in around 6 to 8 weeks. You know, these are the duration of course, but to achieve excellence in that field may take few years. So things to consider before opting gastroenterology. First thing you should have is passion. Without passion, with something else in your mind, I can do this, I can do that, I can earn a lot, that shouldn't be there. Because it's not like MBBS to MD. MBBS to MD, it may be a different setting. You know, people who get a very top rank, you want this subject. I didn't get this rank, so I opted this subject. So you should come out of this. So all of us are MD medicine passed out. So here, it's your passion. If you're passionate towards procedure subjects, go for that. If you're passionate towards research and other subjects, please go for it. Without passion, taking any subject would be a disaster in the life. So things to consider before opting. Sudhanshu was discussing about physical disability and all those things. Of course, we have a lot of physically challenged people who are great gastroenterologists and are practicing now. But only thing is, if you're too much disabled, you know, Gastroenterology would be slightly difficult because you have to work in endoscopy settings. You have 3-4 assistants surrounding you. You have to stand for more than 2 hours, 4 hours, sometimes 6 hours. So it may be a difficult one. Otherwise, definitely you can opt my subject. Recommended institution. This is very important before selecting gastroenterology. Because near presence of in an institute subject will not make it great. To gastroenterology, actually. We had a great energy and other allied subjects. I saw in my during my MD coaching is just endoscopy, colonoscopy going on. So, but once I entered this subject, later I came to the depth of it. Top 5 institutes which I would recommend for you to take up gastroenterology: Chandigarh, CMC Vellore, AIIMS Delhi, and AIG Hyderabad. And there's nothing called DM or DNP. Of course, I agree that the research, the amount of research and the academic feast you get in a institute is entirely different from that of medical college and others. But if you want to opt between a medical college, let us say there's, you have option 1-2 in Hyderabad. One is a medical college, second is a DNB. DM versus DNB. It's better to opt for DNB in a good institute. For example, AAG and Gangaram Hospital Delhi offer excellent DNB training. So rather than selecting some XYZ college in Hyderabad, opting let us say AAG would be definitely beneficial. So these are all some of the top institutes. But if you are somewhere stuck, you know, which one to add, I'm very near to my hometown and everything. Institutes from Northern India have a very good gastroenterology setup when compared to Southern institutes, except for Hyderabad and CMC Vellore. Northern India, you have full-fledged gastroenterology setup in almost all institutes. Another advantage of doing the DM in a good institute is the exposure. You will be exposed to a lot of these things. You will be offered for a lot of international conferences, paper publications, and everything. So, I think this is about our subject, gastroenterology.
Question, sir. Vijay, sir.
Yeah, please, Kishan.
One is, what makes the gastroenterology the most demanding subject branch? Okay. Second thing is, there are so many subspecialties even in gastro, sir, like you already mentioned, hepatology, hepatobiliary maybe, or transplant, or there are so many subspecialties also. So that applies to other branches also. Will that make the field more competitive and more overlapping?
Competitive, yes. Overlapping is also yes. So here what happens, you can specialize in anything you want. Let us say when I was doing my DM in SCPJ Lucknow, Unit 1 was specialized in ERCP and pancreas. Unit 2, they have a specialty in liver-related issues. Unit 3 in motility and lumen disorders. I think once you get exposed to these things, now you can choose. That's why I suggest you to do gastroenterology in a good institute, so that even you can select what to do after that. Another thing is, it's not that saturated. I can say, let us say, I'm from Tumkur, my hometown. Hometown, we don't have any permanent DM gastroenterologist even till today. So that's just it. There is no saturation. And another why it is demanding, another reason, you can see the message box. Somebody asking to punch you, sir, you don't mean what you said. So payment with regard to gastroenterology, there are two ways how gastroenterologists are paid. One is a fixed salary and a procedure-based salary. You know? So you'll get a fixed amount of salary. Upon that, based on the number of procedures you do, based on the type of procedure, complexity of procedure, you're paid extra. That's why we have a little, demanding nowadays.
Vijay, Balaji, do you have any questions for sir?
Sir, what is the reason why almost all, after MD medicine, everyone wishes to go to, choose either gastroenterology? So it is what makes it a very sought after branch.
That's what, if you're interested in intervention,
Of course, you have, other than just intervention daily, you get very challenging cases. It's not that you get a simple liver disease or a simple jaundice to treat. You should understand that if, let us say, a patient comes to you with jaundice, you would have been screened through. Nobody comes to a gastroenterologist first. Of course, in many corporate setups, they do. But in general, what happens, he'll be treated by some XYZ, he'll be treated by Ayurvedic physician, he'll be treated by a general physician, XYZ. And again, at the end, you know, he comes to you. So it is a little challenging when compared to other subjects. And interventions, mainly intervention, I can say daily, you spend at least one third of your time in intervention. If you're interested in it, definitely makes you more challenging. Of course, there are a lot of problematic, you'll have sleepless nights when something happens, you know, let us say a simple pancreatitis, you will lose the sleep, you know. So perforation, pancreatitis, bleed, uncontrollable bleed, they're a part of our job.
Thank you, Vijay sir. Thank you for those.
Thank you, Kishan. Thank you for organizing.
Next, we have another. Please be with us for another 10-20 minutes, sir. Residents have some more questions at the end. And about, we'll also discuss about other minor branches. Meanwhile, we will discuss about yet another demanding branch, that is nephrology. So, Pramod sir is with us to discuss about nephrology. Over to you, sir.
Hello, Kishan. Can you hear me?
Yes,
hello, sir. Good evening, everyone. Can you hear me, Kishan?
Clearly, sir, clearly.
Okay, okay.
Yes, sir, we can hear you. We can hear you, sir,
okay.
Please.
First of all, with a motivational note, I would like to start upon the merits in taking up nephrology. This is one of the actually easiest branch to crack in super speciality, because you have only one book to read, that is Fiali. It is a very small book compared to the other specialty branches like cardiology, gastroenterology. So definitely whoever wants to prepare for nephrology, definitely you can prepare easily. And first and foremost, I would like to tell the students who are pursuing for nephrology, if at all they want to opt in nephrology and want to continue their residency and followed by practice in nephrology, first thing they have to remember that they should have a strong base of medicine knowledge, and it is very helpful and essential in nephrology, because in nephrology per se, it is 80% medicine and it contains 20% of core nephrology. Also, this is a specialty wherein you find equal balance between procedures as well as diagnostic challenges, because suppose if you get a glomerular disease patient, clinically, if you are suspecting glomerular disease, then on further evaluation, you find to have either nephritic or nephrotic picture. And then you do various kinds of diagnostic workup. You need to rule out autoimmune diseases by performing various autoimmune diseases. You need to do complement levels. So that is the diagnostic part. And to establish the tissue diagnosis, again, you need to do a procedure like renal biopsy. So it's a balance between diagnostic as well as procedural part is concerned. And also it gives immense immense satisfaction in providing a comprehensive healthcare, because our patients, patients who are going for end stage renal disease, they have lot of complications. They might be having a cardiac related illness. They will be diabetic, they will be hypertensive, and they will have peripheral vascular diseases also. You need to evaluate each and everything. So you need to have a strong base of medicine, and you need to consider each and every comorbidity, and you can evaluate in each and every comorbidities in detail. So that's how it gives it provides a comprehensive healthcare. And sometimes even while treating the patient, whenever the patient get the results of successful treatment can be seen in front of your eyes. Suppose if you treat any AK patient, he might be requiring dialysis or he may not require hemodialysis. So once they recover, that too during their hospital stay, once they recover, it gives an immense satisfaction, and also it gives utmost pleasure also. Like two patients were admitted under my care. They had acute kidney injury. One patient had acute kidney injury secondary to contrast associated. He was admitted with complaints of chest pain, and initially he had normal renal functions. So they took him for angio, and again on angiogram they had a suspected lesion. So again they wanted to plan for a stenting. So after 2 days they took him up for stenting. So and he was on few of the medications like ACARB inhibitors and diuretics, which we stop prior to the procedure. But in that patient, it was continued. So he ended up with renal failure. So his creatinine was normal initially, and his creatinine was post procedure. After 2 procedures, it went on to sky high, like almost it was 8 to 8.5. So he was managed conservatively without dialysis. So and a few of the literature say that such group of patients can be treated with a small dose of steroid therapies. So since urine picture everything was showing acute interstitial nephritis picture, so we added a small dose of steroid therapy, and he showed a wonderful response. Like creatinine drastically it had come down to 2.5 and all. So we discharged him. So in that way, so treating seeing successful treatment in front of your eyes, like it gives utmost pleasure and satisfaction for you. And even patients who are on dialysis, who are on regular maintenance hemodialysis, if at all they give consent for renal transplantation, and if the transplant is successful, and it is almost like equivalent to giving a rebirth to the patient. He can have a complete normal near normal life compared to his peers. And compared to saturation level in nephrology, like unlike other specialties, if you want to concentrate your practice in two-tier and three-tier cities, still there are a lot of opportunities to practice nephrology, because even government is also coming up with lot of projects like providing hemodialysis care at taluka level and district level, and these are completely government sponsored programs. And also even peritoneal dialysis also they are planning to implement in the government, in one of the government sponsored programs. So in that way you are having lot of opportunities to work even at two-tier and three-tier cities. And one more advantage is, like initially there were no updates, like patients with glomerular diseases, if untreated or undiagnosed at appropriate time, so they used to go for end stage renal disease. So nowadays there are a lot of advances and a lot of newer biomarkers, newer antibody tests have come up, and even newer treatment targeted therapies have come. So once you establish the diagnosis, either through with a proper lab backup or on histopathological grounds, and if you give a proper targeted therapy, even the renal survival of that patient gets prolonged. Like we have seen few of the nephrotic patients, like membranous nephropathy patients, FSGS patients, ANCA-associated vasculitis patients, still they are on immunosuppressive therapy and completely leading near normal life. And to end first part of the discussion, like on a funny note, I would tell that during your residency or post-residency, suppose if you are smart enough and if you have a very good junior doctor under you, this is the only branch that you can manage on phone. Like you can guide them giving proper instructions on phone, and even if they are good at some procedures, like the whatever procedure that can be done on emergency basis is IJV catheterization, that IJV or femoral ST catheterization. If they are good with that, you think that you can manage this specialty on phone. And demerits, I would like to divide into two categories. One, one during the time of residency and post residency. Like during residency, suppose now actually everywhere the seats they have increased in different colleges, but in when I was doing residency, I was the only one. The intake for per year was only one, so I was the only one faculty, one resident working in our department. So I used to get duties almost once in second 2 days or once in 3 days. So in that way, residency will be very, very hectic, and also sometimes it's spending time with family is also very hard, and concentrating on your academic activities also will be very difficult. So one has to be very smart, and he has to plan everything so that the show will keep going on. And one thing I need to tell, residency definitely one will lose at least 10 to 15 kgs of weight in nephrology. Like shirts which I used to wear during the time of residency no longer fit me now, to say that. And coming to the post residency part, see, our nephrology practice is like referral based practice. So like lot of patients first initially they come in contact with the primary care physicians or general Akishan,
and creatinine is point Kishan, more than 0.8, they will be directly referred to nephrologist, sir. Anyone with creatinine more than 0.8 will be
no Kishan, it's a different scenario actually. I'll tell you now. Ours is a referral based practice. So initially the patients will get come in contact with the primary care treating physicians and or a general practitioners. So so you need to have a very good rapport with them. Like you need to visit taluka places, you need to visit PHC centers, and in fact sometimes whenever you are free, at least you need to go once in a week or twice in a week, however you are comfortable. You have to go there and you need to practice there, then only the patient will get familiarized that a nephrologist is coming and is treating the patients, or else it's very difficult to build your patient pool, and lot of groundwork you need to do before you get established. And also like for handling nephro cases, like initially you come out and you want to plan up for a setup, so it's very difficult initially actually, because ours is a specialty wherein there will be lot of dependency. Like we depend on very good ICU team, and we need to have a very good cardiologist also, and we need to have a very good radiologist who help us in doing renal biopsies, and also we need to have a pathologist also, because after biopsy we need to know what exactly is the diagnosis. So it's like a multi specialty care is required in nephrology. So initially doing standalone practice will be very difficult, unlike other specialty branches. And even dialysis unit also, like if you want to set up your own dialysis unit, like it's very difficult initially, because the technicians will be changing frequently. So you need to train them, and you should have a very good backup of technicians who are very good in cannulating AV fistulas. And also you should have a backup of very good nursing staff. And if the hospital is having a 24/7 dialysis facility, and you never know when the patient will become sick or when will be, and suddenly all of a sudden patient will be doing fine, and suddenly they will develop pulmonary edema, they will come to the hospital. So you should make sure that you are available 24/7 in nephrology.
Pramod sir, what are the things we should consider actually before, as a general medicine resident, what are the things I should be considering before? I'm interested, really interested in nephrology. Okay, but any particular things I should consider?
Okay, things to consider, is it? Actually, basically, the things to consider is, ours is a main referral based practice basically. So you need to have a very good rapport with the primary care physicians or general practitioners, so that, and if at all a patient having lot of comorbidity like diabetic, hypertensive, and he has a renal failure, then they will refer to you, and you make sure that you send that patient back to the treating physician for controlling blood sugars. suppose if you start addressing each and every issue on your own, then again you won't get any of the patients like that. So you should have a very good rapport with them, and also you should be and one more thing is you need to spend more time in educating patients, because they have a lot of preconceived notions and or misconceptions, like they do not know like what is the difference between acute kidney injury and chronic kidney disease. So when you diagnose a patient with acute kidney injury and you say that he will require dialysis, what they think is, okay, dialysis means lifelong. So that's the thought they have in their mind. So you need to educate them, and you need to clearly tell them what is the difference till when you are going to continue dialysis, and what are the parameters you are looking into that, and how will be his follow up. Everything you need to tell. And suppose if I want to educate a patient for biopsy, they think that I'll be taking their kidney out from their body. So that such kind of misconceptions they have. So educating the public is also very, very essential. So, and we need to create a lot of awareness programs with regards to nephrology, so that they will get to know what are the things happening in nephrology and what are the treatment strategies which are going to be given to them.
Pramod sir,
can you please
recommend us five major institutions for nephrology? Five top institutions.
Okay. Five institutes, like all central institutes are very, very good. Like PGI is also very good, and STPGI is very good, wherein they do both interventional nephrology as well as glomerular disease plus transplantation. Everything they cover under one roof, STPGI. And even CMC Vellore is also very good, and even St. John's is also very good. And next is with regard to
state medical institutes,
state medical colleges, like Madras Medical College is very good. And next is even DNB institutes, like DNB institutes like Manipal, and even Nanded in Gujarat, and even Apollo Hospitals in New Delhi. They are also very good. Suppose if anyone wants to pursue DNB, it is also very good, these institutes.
What an irony, sir. Pramod sir, see, in fact, in medical is such a competitive field, we don't want anyone else to come into our area. Okay. But still, you guide the juniors so well to take up your, like, you motivate them, and you make it so interesting to take the branch. This can be seen only by few. Okay. Very, very unique virtue. Very thankful to you, sir. Pramod sir.
Thank you, Kishan.
We'll have some more discussion at the end, sir. Before we'll listen to Dr. Sharad sir about the branch of neurology. Sharad sir, sorry for making wait for so long.
No problem, Kishan.
Can you please enlighten us more about neurology, sir?
Thank you, Kishan, for the invitation. So I will be speaking in a slightly different order. First of all, the first things to consider before opting the neurology, I think that would be an appropriate order. So many of the MD postgraduates during their MD days would have been exposed to the specialties in their peripheral postings, and but not all the specialty postings will be covered, I think, in many of the medical colleges. So, hello, am I audible? Hello.
Yes, sir. You're audible.
Yes, sir. We can hear you, sir. Yes.
Yeah. So before opting the neurology, just the personality trait or the what are the qualities in a resident. Like, one thing is the patience level, because neurology is more of a theory thing than an intervention. The interventions are relatively less compared to other specialties in neurology. Even now coming up, there are many interventions coming up, like endovascular therapies, and especially in stroke. However, the number of interventions is less in neurology, and especially the guys who like the complexity of the neurosciences, or who enjoy the clinical examination, because neurology is full of a clinical perspective. I think among all the specialties, neurology has more of a clinical perspective than the other specialties, and also deductive reasoning, verifying at each level and sorting out the differential diagnosis. So like a neurologist has to spend a minimum of around a half an hour to 45 minutes with a patient to arrive at a differential diagnosis if you examine clinically properly. And one more thing is one need to have an extra edge of being more intellectual. And there's the guys who are more comfortable and more enjoying the discussions and more involved in teaching especially will be having definitely a good time with neurology. So it is more basically more of a theoretical rather than a more of an intervention subject. And coming to the next merits and demerits. So once you are like able to sort out based on your personality whether to go for an intervention or a non-intervention, or whether you're a guy who are more involved in discussion, more involved in sorting out the things step by step. Then coming to the merits and demerits, and again, it is more of preferences rather than the merits and demerits. So one is from UG days, neurology is always a fascinating subject to almost each and every medico. And one more thing is the complexity, like many of them will be more fascinated and interested towards this complexity of the subject. And it's obviously an enjoyable subject with maximal clinical perspective involved. And one more thing is while coming to the practice or while treating the patients, you will be having a longitudinal patient relationship and you will be following up the patient for a quite long time. You will be having definitely a satisfaction and the patient, same satisfaction from the patient side also. And comparatively, the number of emergencies are relatively less compared to other specialties. There are also neurological emergencies, but I think they are relatively less compared to others. So you will be having ample time for your personal plans also. And one more thing is the financial thing. I think financial thing will not bother much for any guy who has finished the specialty courses. And almost all the specialties, especially when you take the metropolitans or being the, paid at the almost the same scale, unless if you go to a area of interest or when you like put up your own setup. And so that, and coming to like one of the demerits would be like many of the neurological illnesses, if you see or like chronic illnesses and the progressive illnesses, like especially when you take the movement disorder part, but even now the movement disorder part, like the DBS, deep brain stimulation is now being widely practiced throughout the country. So other mainly the degenerative diseases would make some difference where the illnesses are progressive and the treatment is not very effective. And one more thing is the number of interventions. So if you are more of an intervention kind of guy, then I think the number of, even though like even in neurology, the interventions are coming up, especially the endovascular therapies and especially and also the epilepsy patients, the vagal nerve stimulation. So I think it will be like guys who are liking intervention would also have an edge in neurology. And next, after this pluses and minuses, then the scope. So after neurology, neurology is having a lots of researchers going on. Many of the neurological diseases, as I mentioned, like the degenerative diseases are being researched for the drug. Many drug trials are going on. However, the more diseases to be sorted out, then the more research is going on here. So after the neurology, you can be a clinician or you can be a researcher. You can involve in various research activities and like the institute where I am currently studying, like here also, there's lots of research going on. And even you can approach abroad also for further research, and you can be an academician. So especially the personality trait, as I told, especially those guys who are interested in teaching, who are interested in discussion and who have a good quality, like who are able to spend a good time with the books will be definitely having an extra edge. And so scope is wider. You can practice, you can be a clinician, you can be a researcher, you can be an academician. And coming to the further options after DM neurology, again, as I said, the subspecialties and the are being increased, especially if you take the movement disorder, Parkinson's disease or various other movement disorders, the deep brain stimulation is now rising and not many centers are having the facility or not offering this. Now, I think the number of centers are increasing. So you will be having a really good experience if you go into further subspecialties like movement disorders, especially with deep brain stimulation and some minor procedures like botulinum toxin injections. And in case of stroke, especially in acute stroke and the endovascular therapy is mainly the mechanical thrombectomy, which is now gaining much importance. And the epilepsy surgeries. So the candidacy of the patient for epilepsy surgery is a determination is also a, like the developing subspecialty. And coming to the next thing is the recommended institute. So any institute with a good infrastructure and a good patient load will definitely suffice the requirements of the student. So among the institutes, as we all know, the central institutes are comparatively better equipped with the infrastructure and having a high patient load. So central institutes would obviously occupy the top position for learning neurology. So that's the key.
Sir, I have a serious question for you, Sharad sir.
Yeah.
Like usually humans, the human tendency is to go easy on anything. Okay. But what is the path, neurological pathophysiology behind taking up complex subjects like neurology or this cardiac surgery? What is the pathophysiology, sir?
Actually,
why the people tend to take up all these complex subjects?
Yeah, the thing is, some might have a clear idea of as to what to do, and some might be like more involved in, as I said earlier, more involved in teaching or more involved in step-by-step evaluation, rather than one-go procedure or a one-go visit. So one thing is the inherent tendency of the person, one may be contributing. And another thing is that even from the, if you see from the undergraduation days, so like one, every student, like almost every student will be definitely seeing a stroke patient or any neurology patient from the UG days itself. So they will be having some familiarity with the neurology, but they will be not knowing the finer details or the complexity unless they reach the level of MD or after the MD. So that even in MD also, if you take the postgraduates are much more exposed to neurology cases, especially if you take the practical exams in MD medicine, the long case will be generally a neurology case. So they will be related to neurology and they will be feeling neurology as a most familiar subject, and they will be like, they would feel attracted and fascinated towards neurology. But just as you go depth in like bit by bit, then you will be experiencing the complexity of the subject. So I think many of the students...
I feel this is correct, sir. To know more about the subject or the field, that's fascination, sir. To more learn more and more. That may be the relevant interest to take up neurology. Maybe that's very rightly said, sir. So now we know about new things. Like we have so many other super specialists also coming in our country, especially. Sir, I want to know from the mentors, like what's the scope or like how about taking endocrinology or rheumatology as a career option? Any of the mentors can enlighten us. Vijay sir, are you there?
Kishan.
Yes, sir.
With regards to endocrinology, again, yes. It's basically in metropolitan cities, they are aware about that specialty. Like in 2-tier and 3-tier cities, still they are not aware about a super specialty like endocrinology. Still, whenever they are diabetic, the first whom they visit is a general medicine practitioner. Hmm?
General medicine.
So,
yes, sir.
And the thyroid and diabetes are the bread and butter for endocrinologists. And those two things are completely handled by a physician. So it's very difficult for them in 2-tier and 3-tier cities. But again, if at all they start some awareness campaigns and all, like a lot of growth retardation cases and lot of pivotal endocrine disorders are there, and lot of PCOD cases will be coming to the OPD. So if at all any awareness is there, no, definitely scope much.
But Pramod, sir, my question is, like you told, the bread and butter is mainly the diabetes and the thyroid. But diabetes, sir, it's a capital city in India. So why can't I do just a fellowship, 6 months fellowship in diabetology, and I'll reach it. Nowadays, friend is MD general medicine and diabetologist.
Correct.
In tier 2 or tier 3 cities.
Correct.
Sure. Won't that be suffice?
Correct. Actually, most of them they are doing like that. Actually, after they complete their general medicine course, no, they are opting fellowships, like 4 to 5 months fellowships will be offered at various institutes. They will do that, and their signboard also changes along with that. So they will be treating all these spaces, all these like thyroid diabetic cases.
And that's what Kishan, usually if you go to endocrinologist in major cities now, they deal only some refractory, difficult to treat diabetes, complicated diabetes, and it's more of something beyond diabetes. As Dr. Pramod told, it may be very difficult for them to settle in a tier 2 city or a, let us say, their native place, very small place. It's very difficult. You know, people don't know who are endocrinologists, who are rheumatologists. Nobody goes with a joint pain, you know, directly they don't come to rheumatologists. So for endocrinology, rheumatology, medical genetics is another new subject, you know, only few centers in India offer that course. So these are all the subjects, you know, which are current. I don't know what can happen in future 10, 15 years later. But currently, I think we are focused only for major cities. Otherwise, there is no point in you doing DM endocrinology, go to a tier 2 city, keep seeing only diabetes and this thing where your physicians, you know, your friends will be much, much, much ahead of you. So I think their focus is should be on a major city now, right now. A few years it may develop.
And one more thing, Kishan, like suppose if any growth retardation, retarded first, they should educate them to go and show endocrinologist. But there are some people who say that, okay, this is from like hereditary, and they will they don't try to refer like that.
So health education is the most important thing. Agreed.
Correct.
Okay. So before anything, health education is required. So Sudhanshu sir, I want to have a question for you.
Yeah,
each of the branches we discussed here, it may be cardiology or neurology or gastro, whatever. Nowadays we tend to see a trend like there's a pediatric cardiology and adult cardiology, pediatric nephrology, and let's say, will that make a like lot of difference when you do super specialty, or is it really significant, or a difference is there?
Sudhanshu
sir,
Kishan, so whatever what you said about differences between pediatric and adult practices, is it's definitely there is a big difference when it comes to super specialty. Although an adult cardiologist can try to practice pediatric cardiology to some extent, a pediatric cardiologist can try to practice adult cardiology to some extent, same thing for gastroenterology. But definitely, I would say, you know, the future is of super specialties, and probably, you know, subspecialties in those super specialties. People are becoming more and more aware. And definitely, if you have a pediatric cardiologist in your vicinity, you would like to go to that person, because he is very well trained in that particular core. In my DM, I've seen when there is a pediatric cardiologist around, the way he sees cases, pediatric cases, especially if he's from a pediatric background, it is totally different when an adult cardiologist sees a pediatric case. So definitely there is a big difference. So if you are from pediatrics background and you choose to, you know, practice pediatric cardiology, there is scope for that. There is definitely a scope for that. And you can practice it far better and far, you know, guideline based and specialized way compared to an adult cardiologist. Same goes for pediatric nephrologists and adult nephrologists also. My wife is currently doing a fellowship in pediatric nephrology, and I can see the way they approach, you know, pediatric cases. It's entirely different from what we used to see adult cases when I was a medicine resident. So totally different. And I have very little experience as far as infants are concerned in nephrology, but I would say the way she tells me, definitely there is a difference. So if you are a pediatrician and you're planning for pediatric super speciality, definitely there is a scope and you can practice differently. Although there is mixing there. Also, as far as endocrinology is concerned, I would like to pitch in here. The guys for whom we are actually speaking are going to, you know, they're going to join super speciality in next few years, and they'll come out in next 5 or 6 years. So people are getting more and more health conscious nowadays. They are learning about super speciality. I've seen people from my villages and people from, you know, far off places in Karnataka specifically asking for endocrinologists. So they are asking, and I have friends in St. John's and all, and I do recommend them to go there. So nowadays, and you never know what will happen in next 5 or 6 years. So although there are people who are diabetologists nowadays and who are practicing in second tier cities, but now you see how cardiologist has moved to third tier cities nowadays. So similarly, I feel ki, especially, I mean, if not now, in next 5 to 6 years, definitely other branches, other super specialties will move to second tier and third tier cities, and definitely there is no shortcut to this. I mean, I would never recommend a MD medicine resident to go for a 1 year fellowship in endo or nephro or anything.
Great.
If he or she is getting a DM, definitely there is a scope for that. And if you can do a DM, finish 3 years, the confidence that you get once you come out of it, if you are a DM endo or you sit in front of a diabetologist, the confidence that you have is entirely different. So, and at a different level. So if you go to that second tier town and sit in front of a diabetologist, nobody will go to him.
Yes. Santosh sir, I have a specific question for you. Yours is a branch, like a versatile and variety of cases, sir. Head to toe, you can deal with all kind of cancers. But having said that, you also have a lot of overlapping also nowadays, because see, even a hepatitis HCC may be dealt by even the gastroenterologist also, or by hepatobiliary specialist also, or even by oncologist also, whereas the gynec oncology, even gynecologist can deal with that, or oncologist can deal with that also. So many, lot of overlapping also there. And also lot of cases also there, variety of cases. So how you deal with that? Who are your basic who will refer the patients to you, and how you deal with this competition and what's the overlapping in the field of oncology?
Kishan,
one field Kishan, where, like for example, in our hospital, less and less people want to treat cancer. Like for example, gastroenterologist may give initial treatment, but eventually they have to send the patient to the oncologist. So there is one area where radiation oncologists do treat medical oncology patients and do give chemotherapy. However, with growing awareness, patients do choose medical oncologists for the chemotherapy part and are tending to go to radiation oncologists only for the radiation part.
Hello.
Yes, what sir. I mean to say is less and less people are.
We understood, sir. Vijay sir, you want to add something to that?
Yeah.
But
Kishan, at this point, you know, I'd like to give an example. We had one of our patients who was initially followed up by a general physician, cirrhosis followed up by a general physician. Once he had decompensation, complicated cirrhosis, he came to us. Okay. Then he had hepatocellular carcinoma. Then we took help of a gastrosurgery, surgical gastro people, to resect it. So we need their help at that time. They resected it. After resection, again, a patient came back to us a few months later with a recurrence. Then we took help of our interventional radiologist for ablating the tumor. Despite ablation, again, he had a multiple tumors in a throat, the left lobe and everything. Initially, we started chemotherapy. Of course, there was no good response for sorafenib-based thing despite having portal vein invasion. Then we referred him to our oncologist friends. So I think it's a teamwork rather than taking this patient belongs to me, this patient belongs to them. So teamwork always works in super specialty, both in, I think in all subjects, sir, teamwork is the key.
I'm really sorry to say to all my mentors, but like finally tell me please, whether we are really doing a super specialty or it's a subspecialty. I want to know.
It's a subspecialty. Only in India it is super. Rest, everywhere it is subspecialty.
Ultimately, sir, what I felt is by doing all those things, we are all becoming patient-centric. It may be a little boring to see. We may be knowing much more during our MD days or MS days. Now we are confining ourselves to the only one particular organ. Now in surgery, it has come up in such a way that
surgery based surgeons have come. Only one surgery, fistula surgery is doing. Only lap cholecystectomy is doing. Only one surgery is doing. All this happening just to give or better treatment for the patient. So patient centric treatment has come up. So, but we can't deny the fact that we also becoming more of holistic in approach with the multidisciplinary aspects. So we might have talked all about our branches today, but ultimately we also know that we also realize that we are all mutually dependent, just like Vijay sir mentioned now. So initially gastro people tried, and then we had to take up the help of the onco people. Then also like we are all interrelated and intermingling and also interdependent. So it's a teamwork. Ultimately, the take home message of today's session is, yeah, we will be specialists in one particular aspect or one particular branch, agreed, but also we are also team working here for as a holistic approach for the best possible care of a patient. Sir, agree? Concluding remarks shortly, sir.
Yeah.
One made by all the mentors.
This will be my last thing. What I would tell is, see, there's no hurry in taking up DM or DNB after your MD. Of course, we have a lot of stress, a lot of peer pressure and everything after MBBS to do some specialty. So after MD medicine or MD pediatrics, we don't have so much pressure or anywhere. Okay. What I would suggest my juniors here, students here is to work in a particular subspecialty for at least 6 months.
Yeah.
It will definitely give you content. Yeah. For example, the gastro department where I did my MD medicine, I can say this was nothing. I can score it out of 2 out of 10. So people, whatever the super subspecialty or super specialty which they are exposed to, except for some institutes will definitely have an advantage. So because oncology is not good in most of the medical colleges, so what people should do is work in a good setting. Suppose endocrinology, rheumatology.
There's some network issue with Vijay sir. I would like to say working is important for two things.
Yeah.
Vijay sir, two things like you said. One thing comes to know about a real interest.
Yeah.
When we work in that particular branch, we come to know how much we are really interested, or else it may be just a fascination from looking outside.
You should know where
second
you fit in
is,
actually.
When we have a experience, especially in interviews in central institutes, they particularly look for the experience in the field. So if I have worked in a department for 1 year or so, that really means that I'm really interested in the field. So they want to take up such candidates who are really interested in the field, who are passionate about and who have experience. In that way also, this helps working before the super specialty for 1 year or 2 years. It's never a waste. It's never a waste. So that's a very good idea, sir.
Actually before NEET, it was like a mandatory thing. Like people used to work in the respective field of interest, and then they used to give entrance exams. But now after NEET, Everyone works in a department where there is no work. They will keep on reading for their super specialties.
Santosh sir?
I agree that NEET has changed things. Unfortunately, now people have to read post the way they read post MBBS and kind of guess the branch they wish they like. And many times people after joining the branch get depressed and leave the branch. And this has happened one student of ours left last year after paying a huge amount of initial fees. He gave up the fees and left the branch within 15 days of joining. So definitely, trying to get exposed to the field before you jump into the field, at least for a few months, 1 or 2 months, 3 months, would be very useful to make sure that you like the branch before you really jump into the branch.
Sharat sir and Sudhanshu sir.
Vijay sir told like one should be taking some time and one should have a clarity before opting the specialty course. There is no hurry after MD. You can have enough time to decide upon. You can get exposure to the concerned subspecialties and you can get to know more about the subspecialties and then decide and then get on to pursuing the DM course. So especially like obviously like one who have like some exposure before entering the DM will have an extra edge after joining the DM course. So I think one has to get a clarity immediately, like they can take their time after MD and get clarity on which specialty to enter into and then can pursue accordingly.
So with those thought-provoking insights and valuable suggestions and guidance from our mentors, we shall Sudhanshu sir, yeah, Sudhanshu sir is left. Sorry. Sudhanshu sir, please, one concluding remarks, please.
Yeah, okay. So to sum up my point, in my point of view in this is, I would say, yeah, definitely what Vijay sir told is right, that you have to work in that particular department and you have to like the branch before you join. But my personal advice to all the juniors is that along with the branch also, see the practical aspects of other things also. Do weigh the pros and cons for, sit for a month or so, do weigh the pros and cons of everything, like which place you belong to, how is your family background, how, where you want to practice, where, whether you want to go to a medical college, you want to be academically oriented, or whether you want to be in a corporate setup, what is your area of interest, you want to do interventions or you want to do a research or something, you want to be a teacher. So whatever, to take all the points in consideration, measure the pros and cons, see what cons you can, you know, do away with, what cons can you can manage once after joining the subspecialty. And then if you take a whole, you know, decision after seeing everything, definitely you will not face any difficulty. Most of the branches of medicine subspecialties, most of the branches are interesting. And frankly speaking, once you start practicing after a particular point of time, everything becomes same. I mean, it becomes more like, you know, driving a car. It becomes, even Dr. Vijay sir will, support me in this, even doing endoscopy, EUS, and same with cardiology interventions, everything becomes more like a habit sort of thing. Everything, even nephrology, I mean, I don't think after you have put like thousands of dialysis catheters, if you have done that, it will become like a simple job for you. So definitely it matters what is your interest, but ultimately everything becomes like a day's job for you. So do take everything into consideration and take a balanced decision about what you want to pursue, how you want to pursue, where you want to live, what is the status there, and how you want to go ahead with the subspecialty, and then decide what you want to choose. Thank you.
Very well said, sir. Really appreciate it. Very well said, Sudhanshu sir. Dr. Vijay Balaji, by now you must be like very much admiring what these mentors are like, what these mentors have already achieved and what they're really doing, and how nicely they have guided us, the juniors. Balaji, I think this session for especially for the medicine residents, also for you and I being the surgical residents, even I got some insights about the like how the branches work and how really we to go about other things. And it's in general, everyone must, every medico should know about. If we are not doing also, we should know, have we should have a general idea. For example, what's really they're doing in oncology. If I know, I can refer my patients accordingly. I know I have a clear cut thought about what they're doing in the nephrology or oncology, and so that things also indirectly get benefited. If you know, it's very good only. Okay, so more knowledge we have, it's in fact this part. So we'll try to know more and more about everything. So hats off to all our dear mentors here. So constantly supporting us, motivating us, and guiding us. Dear members, I, on behalf of all the members of White Army, all the viewers, and members, Sudhanshu sir, and Pramod sir, and Sharad sir, 7 o'clock we have a session coming. Would you like to super? At 7 o'clock, we shall have at another session on how to select super specialty branch in surgery. Please join us back for at 5 minutes or so. Thank you so much once again.
Thank you.
Thank you, Kishan.
Yeah.
Thank you, Kishan.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Kishan.
Thank you for all your valuable time. I really appreciate.